Today we will start our next theme, that is kinship, caste and class. Historians often use textual traditions to understand the socio-economic changes of the society. In this case, it is very necessary to keep in mind who composed what and for whom. The language and the ways in which the text is circulated are also important. The changes in political and economic life between the 600 BCE and 600 CE century influenced early Indian societies. This chapter discusses issues in social history including caste, class, kinship and gender. It also introduces how textual traditions have been used by historians to reconstruct and social history. Now, the historians used the textual material to understand the social and economic structure of the society. Kuch aise texts the which laid down the norms of the social behavior. Some gave an idea about what were the social practices in the society. We can catch a glimpse of some social actors from inscriptions. Each text inscription was written from the perceptive of social categories. So we need to keep in mind who composed it and for whom. We'll also consider the language of the text. Now, whatever was going on, we understood about the society is influenced or is based on the story of Mahabharata. How, what was the norms for getting the throne, how marriages were conducted, how people had relationship between brother and sister, husband and wife, king and his subjects. Everything is defined on the basis of Mahabharata, as it's an epic. Epic means something which is changing. So everything which is written or discussed in Mahabharata are a way to understand how the society flourished. Yeah, what were the ways the society used to follow? Now, the Kauravas and Pandavas are the main heroes of the story of Mahabharata. One was the Kauravas and the Pandavas. Kauravas were the son of elder brother and Pandavas were the son of younger brother. Now, there is one person called Sukhanthankar. He's a Sanskrit scholar of India and undertook a project work of preparing a critical edition of the Mahabharata and appointed a team of various Sanskrit scholars. So they collected the various versions of Mahabharata which were in the subcontinent from different parts of our country, and they compiled it. They actually did a work that all the verses which they found common used to be kept on one place, or if there kind of any discrepancy was found, they used to mention it in footnotes. So this Mahabharata which they composed was compiled, and it was having all sorts of variations included in it. So finally they selected the verses that appeared common to the most of the versions. So this is a picture of the Mahabharata which was recomposed or edited by V.S. Sukhanthankar. Now, they published around a volume of around 13,000 pages, and there were some common elements of Sanskrit versions of the story. Enormous regional variations were also found, and which were characterized and kept in it. This was a complex process. Structure of family, kinfolk, norms of family and kinship. So, families usually form part of a larger network of people defined as relatives or skin feathers. While familial ties are often regarded as natural and based on blood, they are defined in many different ways. It is more difficult to reconstruct the familial relationships of ordinary people than allied families. So it is very difficult for us to understand the story behind a common man, because whatever we understood is from the basis of Mahabharata, and Mahabharata is the story of king family. So whatever relationships, whatever the way they used to live, they used to have the bondings between the two people of same family, is actually on the basis of the people reside there. Now, the idol of paternity idea of kinship and succession. Main thing is that everything was descendant from the paternal side. Maternal side was not important. So whatever comes from mother's side is not considered important, but whatever is from father's side is given to their son. So son is the main claimant for the property, everything, whatever his father possesses, whatever their mother had from their family side, it was never claimed by the son. So sometimes of other kinsmen claim the throne, and it was a very exceptional case. That is Prabhavati Gupta. Last lesson we discussed that Prabhavati Gupta, who was Samudgupta Maurya's second daughter, she had a land grant. Otherwise, no women had ever been permitted to have property. Now, what are rules of marriage? Dharma Sutra recognize 8 forms of marriage. Out of them, first 4 are considered good form of marriages, and the last 4 are considered as bad. They were never considered good. So women could not get any share of her paternal property. As I have told you, that everything is from father's side, which is handed over to his son. Daughters were never eligible for getting anything from their father's side. Exogamy matlab marrying outside, that means not marrying a boy or a girl who never belongs to your own family. So, and the kanyadan was a biggest gift which is till date considered as a very big gift for the parents, especially for the father. Now, 8 forms of marriages we have discussed here. So the first, fourth, fifth and sixth form of marriage from the Manusmriti will be discussed here, and the rest will be discussed in the further slides. The gift of a daughter after dressing her in costly clothes and honoring her with presence of jewels to a man learned in the Veda, whom the father himself invites. This is the first kind of marriage which generally we follow, that the boy is being invited to marry the daughter, and the daughter is dressed properly, she has gifts from her father's side, and then the marriage is performed. So this is the first kind of marriage which we all follow till date. Now, what is the fourth kind of marriage? The gift of a daughter by the father after he has addressed the couple with the text, "May both of you perform your duties together," and has shown honor to the bridegroom. So in this kind of marriage the groom is not invited, but both are being blessed that they can live their life by themselves. In fifth kind of marriage, when the bridegroom receives a maiden after having given as much wealth as he can afford to the kinsmen and to the bride herself according to his own will, this is when the bride's will is in front. That is Swayamvar kind of thing. Sixth, the voluntary union of a maiden and her lover. This is the sixth kind of marriage which we nowadays call as love marriage. That means the couple are individually accepting each other, and they are performing the marriage. Now, types of marriage. Endogamy means when you are married within the unit, that means within the same family. This is a kind of practice which is nowadays followed by Muslims or the South Indian people, and where the people from their own family are being married together. Like if we talk about in Muslim scenario, these people are married to their own brothers, and this is endogamy. Exogamy is what we generally follow, the Hindus follow, that the bride, the girl is always married to a person who doesn't belong to her family. Polygamy means when they when a man has several wives. This is also which we can have an idea from the Muslim culture, that a man can marry 2 to 3 wives. So this is polygamy. Polyandry is the example which we find in Mahabharata, like Draupadi, one woman who has many husbands. Now, what is Dharma Sutra and Dharma Shastra? Dharma Sutra is basically from 500 BC, codes of social behavior were compiled in Dharma Sutra, and Dharma Shastra written in Sanskrit. The most important Dharma Sutra was Manusmriti, compiled between 200 BCE and 200 CE. Now, what is Gotra? Gotra is basically referred as name given to a particular group of people descendant from one Vedic saint. So a person who belongs to the same gotra cannot marry the person having the same gotra. So this is what here endogamy and exogamy can be understood, that if your gotra is same, then you cannot marry. If you are marrying, that is endogamy. If you are not marrying, then that is exogamy. Now the system says that a woman has to have gotra from her father's side, but as soon as she gets married, her gotra is changed and she has to have now her husband's. Women were expected to take up the gotra of her husband upon marriage and gave up their father's gotra. Members of the same gotra could not marry. When we examine the names of the women married to the Satavahana ruler, now this is the exception of gotra system, because the Satavahana rulers have you will find that they have they had names derived from their father's gotra, such as mother's gotra, such as Gautama and Vasistha. So Satavahanas are the exception for the thing. They retain their these names instead of adopting names derived from their husband's gotra as introduced by the Brahmical rules. So they never have their own names, matlab they never changed their names after marriage. They kept it as their father's gotra. They never changed it. As I have told you further earlier, that when a lady gets married, her gotra is now what her husband's gotra is. But Satavahana was that is an exception, where the father gotra is not left, the lady had her father's gotra only. Some of the women married to Satavahana ruler belong to the same gotra. So here you can see that they have also adopted endogamy, which is again the against the rules of Brahmical texts. As it is obvious, this ran counter to the ideal of exogamy recommended in the Brahmical text. In fact, it exemplifies an alternative practice, that of endogamy or marriage within the kin group, which was prevalent among the several communities in South India. Such marriage among the kin folk ensure a close-knit community. Now, inscriptional evidences regarding the inheritance of gotra among Satavahana, where mothers were important. Now, Satavahana rulers were identified through metronymics, which suggests that mothers were given importance. Here, the succession of the throne was generally paternally, matlab the son will get whatever his father had, he'll get the throne. But in several inscriptions of Satavahana ruler mention the name of their mothers rather than their fathers. For example, Gautami Putra Satakarni, son of Gautami. So here again an exception can be seen, that though they have followed the patrilineal fact that the throne was given to the son after his father, but the son never gave up his name and he always added his mother's name before his own name. Caste social differences within and beyond the framework of caste. Caste refers to set of hierarchical ordered society categories laid down in Dharma Sutra and Dharma Shastra. So it's a hierarchical system where they claim that Brahmins were always on the top and Shudras were always at the bottom. They claim this order as a divinely order. That means the Brahmin says that the God has defined this kind of system in the society. The Dharma Sutra and Dharma Shastra describes the rules about the idol occupation of four categories or varnas. The Brahmanas were supposed to teach Vedas, perform sacrifices and get sacrifices performed, give and receive gifts. Kshatriyas were always engaged in warfare, they were protector of the society. And they get sacrifices performed and make gifts. If we talk about Vaishyas, Vaishya were expected to give gifts, get sacrifices performed and study Vedas, in addition to engage agriculture, pastoralism and trade. If we talk about the Brahmanas developed three strategies to enforce the Varna system. The first was that the Brahmanas asserted that the Varna order was divine origin. That means they always gave this emphasis that if you are not following this, God will be punishing you. Secondly, they advised the king to ensure that there should be Varna in the society so that the kingdom should be working in the proper form. And thirdly, Brahmanas attempted to persuade the people that their status was determined by birth. The third way they used to ensure the Varna system in the society, that they used to always say that everything is given by God and by birth. If you are being birthed in Shudra category, then you cannot think of doing anything else but to serve the society. Indian king of non-Kshatriya origin. So now we will discuss that, as we know that the according to the Varna system, the Kshatriyas are the persons of the society who are engaged in warfare and they are basically the protector of the society. So but in due course of time, when we take the we look upon the textual material, we find a few variations in it, like that any person who is able to master support and resource need to not to be dependent on theory of the birth. So in some way, if a person who is eligible, who can control the society, who can guide the society, who can protect the society, can be a king. Okay, for example, there are different opinions regarding the origin of the Mauryas. Later Buddhist texts suggest that they were Kshatriyas, while the Brahmical texts describe them as the rulers of low origin. So if we talk about Kshatriyas, they are higher in the Varna category, but if we talk about Mauryan dynasty, they are being considered as from lower origin, but they became the king and it's a very big dynasty. The immediate successor of Mauryas were Sungas and Kanvas, and they were Brahmanas, and Brahmanas are considered to the people who study Vedas, who are basically there to perform Vedic puja part and everything. So here they became the king, and this is again an exceptional case in category of Kshatriyas. The Satavahana king Gautami Putra Satakarni claimed to be Brahman and destroyed the Kshatriya's pride. So again, there's an exception, and these are the exceptions which you have to consider. Now, the people who are considered a bit down in the society, they were known as lechas. The Shaka and Kushana rulers who came from Central Asia were regarded as barbarians or outsiders and known as lechas. Some powerful lechas were familiar with Sanskrit tradition. Now, what is Jati? When people were not able to categorize people on the basis of these four varnas, then they had to adopt according to their occupation, and this category was known as jatis. Social category referred to as jatis, like varna jati was also based on birth. Whatever your father used to do, you have to do the same. If you are from the farmer's family, then you will continue to be a farmer. If you your father, your forefathers were from blacksmith family, that means their profession was blacksmith. They were professionally blacksmith. That means their descendants will also be in the same profession. They cannot change the profession. The varnas were fixed at four, but there were no restrictions on number of jatis. In fact, whenever Brahmical authorities encountered new group that did not fit into the fourfold of the varna system, they classified them as jatis. For instance, people living in forests such as Nishads were classified as jatis. Jatis which shared a common occupation or profession were sometimes organized into guilds. The stone inscription found in Mandasar, that is Madhya Pradesh, provides information about this social process and nature of guilds. It records the history of a guild of a silk weaver who originally lived in Gujarat and shifted to Mansur along with their kin folks and children. This is an exception that he changed his profession. He was before, when he was in Gujarat, he was a silk weaver. The membership of the guild was based on shared craft specialization. Some members adopted different occupation. The inscription informs us that apart from the common profession shared by the members, they also collectively decide to invest their wealth earned from through craft and constructed a splendid temple in honor of the sun god. Beyond the four varnas, there were populations whose social practices were not influenced Brahmical ideas such as Nishads, nomadic pastoralists, etc. There was a sharing of ideas and beliefs between these people. Now, this is a very important part of your chapter. There is an 8-mark question from this portion in this paper also, 2019 paper. So, what are untouchables? And what are their duties according to the Manuspriti and Shastras? Now, untouchables are considered those people who were in the hierarchy at the lowest level. They were considered as pollutant in the society. They used to perform rituals which were considered not pure. So they avoided taking food from untouchables. Their main duty was to dispose of the corpses, the dead bodies, and they were known as chandals. Now the untouchables had to do was they used to use the utensils which were thrown or which were used by the dead. They used to wear clothes what the dead body used to wear, and they used to live outside of the society, and they could not walk inside the village in the daytime. They were only allowed to come in the night time, and the dead bodies who don't have any relative, even that dead bodies were disposed of by these chandals. Okay. According to these people who were visitor in our country, that these untouchables used to make some sound. They were not allowed to enter the village simply they had to make some sound so that the people of the village can move away from the area where they were coming, so that not even their shadow could touch them, because if their shadow of an untouchable will touch the common man will become dirty. So they had to make this kind of sound so that they should clap, or they should do some make some sound so that the people could make out that some chandal or untouchable is coming in this area. So they used to run away from that area. There were instances of chandals who were not accepting the life of degradation prescribed in the shastras. Beyond birth, resources and status. The social position of different sections were often shaped by their access to the economic resources. The criteria on which property is granted is as follows: on the basis of gender, on the basis of varna. Property can only be acquired on these two categories. Either your gender is male or you have a varna of prescribed position. Now, gender to access, in this again you will have an understanding that the access to the resources shape in the society differences between men and women. According to Manusmriti, the women were not eligible to claim a share in the paternal property. Whatever their father gives them in the at the time of marriage was only thing which they used to get from their fathers. They cannot claim anything from their fathers. The paternal property was divided among sons after the death of the parent, which with a special share for the eldest son. The eldest son gets more than the younger son, and only the sons are eligible to get property. The women could retain the gift that they have received on the at the time of occasion marriage, but nothing else can be by them. Gender access to property, this could be inherited by her children without the husband having any claim on it, and whatever the women has received at the time of marriage can easily be transferred to her children, but she doesn't have to ask for this from her husband. According to Manusmriti, women were not supposed to hoard family property and their own valuables without their husband's permission. Both epigraphic and textual evidences suggest that while upper class women may have had access to resources, land, cattle and money were generally controlled by men. We know that the society is men oriented, that means the male oriented society, so everything is in under the hands of males. According to Brahmical texts, the only occupation prescribed for Shudras were servitude, that means they had to serve the society, while a variety of occupations were assigned to the first three Varnas. The wealthiest people would have been the Brahmanas and Kshatriyas. That is why the king were the most wealthiest persons of the society, and same was the status of the Brahmanas. Buddhism recognized that division of society is prevalent in society, but did not regard these as natural or flexible. They also rejected the idea of claim for higher status on the basis of birth. According to Tamil Sangamman, this text is also considered in last chapter, if you remember. Anthologies illustrate economic social relationships, suggesting that while there were differences between rich and poor, those who controlled resources were expected to share them. Okay, exploring social differences, a social contract. The myth found in Sutta Pitaka suggests the institution of kingship was based on human choice, with taxes as form of payment for services rendered by the king. At the same time, it reveals recognition of human agency in creating and institutionalizing economic and social relations. It also recognized the fact that since human beings are responsible for creation of the system, they could also change it in future. The king was elected by the whole people. This is Mahasmanta. Historians and the Mahabharata. Now, what according to the historians, Mahabharata could be analyzed. So the elements which are considered by the historians regarding this text are the language, the text which is used in it, whether it was for the ordinary people or for the priest and elite people. Because if we talk about any normal novel which is very much in the public for reading, generally those novels which are in a very general language is always praised by the common man. And if it has a very hard English or very heavy vocabulary used in it, then it is not praised by the common man. Because when you have to consult all the time dictionary, then you will never be happy with the novel. So first of all, the Mahabharata was the language of Mahabharata is considered that whether it is for the common man or for the elite or priests only. The kind of text, whether it was a mantra or a story. Next, author's perspective in writing the text, whether the author wanted to show the good things of the ruler or it wanted to show the bad things of the ruler. The audience to whom it was text, what was the audience to whom it was written, that means for whom it has been written, for the common man or for the elite. Date of the composition or compilation of the text. The text can be easily through carbon dating and everything can be understood that this text was written for in which era. The place of composition, where it has been written. We have been considering the Sanskrit language Mahabharata. The Sanskrit used in the Mahabharata is simpler than that of the Vedas or of the Prashasti. That means this was probably written for the common man, but that better understood by the people. Okay, now who wrote this text? The original story was composed by chariot bards known as Sutas, who accompanied the Kshatriya warriors to the battlefield and composed poems celebrating their victories and other accomplishments. So first of all, the people who were in the main battlefield along with these big kings, the Kshatriyas, they were their chariot bards, that the persons who used to drive their chariots. They were the people who wrote this Mahabharata. These compositions were circulated orally by 5th century BCE. The Brahmanas began to commit this to writing. Then they started writing about it. And it is also possible that the upheaval occurring in the social values being replaced by new norms at this time were reflected in Mahabharata. It may be that this is the time when these things were reflected in Mahabharata. Another phase in 200 CE and 200 BCE, when worship of Vishnu was growing and Krishna was being identified with Vishnu. Maybe because of this, because in Mahabharata Krishna played a very vital role in the whole story. So maybe because of this, this text was written. Between 200 and 400 CE, didactic section resembling the Manusmriti were added. Historians and the Mahabharata. All these additions made the text, which started with less than 10,000 verses to 1 lakh verses. This work is traditionally attributed to, say, Ved Vyas. We all know that Ved Vyas nahi likhi thi ye. The text presented is classified into two sections. One that contains stories designated as the narrative. Other section containing prescriptions about social norms known as didactic. This section includes stories and narratives containing social message. So one section is actually describing you the whole scene, and the second section is telling you that what does it implies. Excavations of Hastinapur. Excavations of Hastinapur, which is in Meerut, UP, were conducted in 1951-52 by B.B. Lal of Archaeological Survey of India. Houses of this period were built of mud, brick as well as burnt bricks. jars and brick drains were used for draining out refuse water. Terracotta ring wells have been used both as well as and drainage pits. Polyandry marriage in Mahabharata. I have already told you Draupadi is an example of polyandry. It may be because of the shortage of women due to incessant wars or due to situational crisis, and also that narrative sometimes does not reflect the social reality. Why it is considered as a dynamic text, which is a changing text? So Mahabharata is written in variety of languages. It is written, those people who wrote verses of the epic added stories originated or circulated in their localities. The central story of the epic was often retold in many ways. Episodes were depicted in sculptures and painting. They are also provided them themes for a wide range of performing arts, plays, dances and other kinds of